Good evening, everyone. I don't know if it was a good idea to serve the alcohol before, but hopefully that's good. Well, thanks a lot for the great turnout. We are very happy to have you here. And I'm sure you're going to enjoy the conversation from our amazing guest speakers as well in the coming hour. So my name is Burak Cakmak. I'm the Dean of Fashion for Parsons School of Design. And we are very happy to partner with Zadie to put together this session together. It's about a topic that we really care about. So I just want to briefly give a bit of information about our partner here, Zadie, as well, so that you know more about the brand. So Zadie celebrates the Future Fashion, a summit that honors pioneers, industry leaders, and rising talent who are creating the sustainable future fashion. And they're an e-commerce platform. If you haven't seen it already, please take a look at it. But with a mission to make clothes that that are created in the way they should be. That fits right, but also feel great and inspire. So it's about creating exciting alternatives to fast fashion. That's about sustainable, but also considered design. So their compendium of research on the environmental and social impact of the fashion worldwide, which they call the new standard, if you haven't seen it, serves as a guide that allows it to re-envision the trend-driven, disposable approach to clothing that has overtaken our closets. So I have gotten a chance to look at it, and I must admit it gives a lot of good insights into how a standard in a company needs to look like. So they're also a fashion brand, I have to acknowledge that. That's also looking at creating timeless pieces constructed by expert craftsmen using the finest materials. So they're developing their own product around the principles derived from their new standard, looking at longevity, highest quality fibers, lowest environmental footprint, and choosing and working with partners through their entire supply chain. So these are all the values that not only the new standard promotes, but Zadie lives by them with the rules in their own brand. But a lot of us also try to convey as we educate at Parsons. So one of the reasons we were very happy to inaugurate this initiative together with Zadie is that sustainability, especially when it comes to fashion, is something that we are very passionate about. And we want to make sure that we embed it across our curriculum in every design course that we are providing to our fashion students. In that journey, we're looking at many, many different approaches and values, and definitely things like new standard is on our radar to see how we are sharing with all of the young designers that are graduating from Parsons. So you will see a lot more from Parsons around especially embedding sustainable thinking into design, especially when it comes to fashion. And we're looking forward to showcasing all of the great work coming out with the society in mind in our end of year festival in May. So please feel free to visit us the second and third week of May at the school as well. But I would like to welcome Zadie at this point, the co-founder, Maxine Bédat, on the stage, and she'll be able to take us through the session from this point on. Maybe I can briefly touch on that with a background in international diplomacy and United Nations, along with a law degree. She has founded the Bootstrap Project, an organization dedicated to changing the lives of artisans in developing countries. She subsequently spent time with craftsmen in Zambia, Tajikistan, Nepal, providing her with the initial inspiration for the brand that she's running. Thank you, Maxine, if you can come to the stage.
Thank you so much, Dean Cakmak, for the kind introduction and for hosting this evening's summit with us. Under your leadership, Parsons School of Fashion is now not only the preeminent institution for fashion design, it's also really transforming the students into future leaders who really understand their role and responsibility as they go out into the broader world. So you really are an inspiration to all of us at Zadie, so thank you. This is our second year serving as US chairs of Fashion Revolution Day, a global movement that began as an immediate reaction to the collapse of Rana Plaza 3 years ago. It is an honor for all of us at Zadie to share this evening with all of you. So tonight we're paying respect to the 1,134 individuals who perished in that disaster. And we're doing that by coming together to vision the future of the industry and by honoring the visionaries leading the way to a brighter future. So represented in this room this evening are the leaders of the fashion ecosystem. You are brand executives, manufacturing leaders, members of the media, financiers, government leaders, creative strategists, and leaders within multilateral organizations, including the United Nations and the World Economic Forum. In short, all of you are the team that will be determining fashion's future. So as we think about today how we're going to create that future we wish to see in the world, let's first just take a moment to reflect on the current state of the industry. Because only if we know where we are can we know where we're going to go. As the leadership of IKEA recently stated, we are today experiencing peak stuff. Consumers have never had so much clothing at such dirt cheap prices. To be more precise, we have purchased 100% more clothing this year than we did 30 years ago, and we wear those pieces on average only 7 times. Globally, that is adding up to an astonishing 150 billion new pieces of clothing made every single year. If you do the math, that is about 20 pieces of new clothing for each man, woman, and child on this planet. This dramatic increase of stuff came about as trade barriers were lowered, which created a financial incentive for brands to source production in countries where which lowered labor costs, which caused clothing prices to fall so that consumers could financially afford to buy more while spending less. To put some data behind that, in 1965, when trade protections were in place, 95% of clothing Americans wore was American made. Even as late as the 1990s, 50% of our clothing was American made, while today it is less than 2%. This outsourcing resulted in an 80% reduction of domestic apparel manufacturing jobs from 1990 to 2011. But of course, we don't need all of that clothing that's being made. It was only through the rise of fast fashion, a business model based on the fabrication of hypertrends and clothing that doesn't last, what other industries call planned obsolescence, that consumers were first convinced to accumulate all that stuff. To get clothing cheap enough for this type of disposable model has required both cheap labor and cheap material. But it turns out that both of these cheap inputs have come with devastatingly high unaccounted for costs. So in order to get lower costs, we've turned to that cheap material, polyester. It's a plastic made from fossil fuels. Today, polyester is now in more than 50% of our clothing. This turns out to be a little problematic for 2 primary reasons. First, polyester is non-biodegradable. Every bit of that stuff that has been produced is still with us today. Second, polyester, along with its other synthetic family, requires enormous energy to manufacture. It's not just what is being manufactured for our clothing, but where it's being manufactured as well. Our energy-intensive manufacturing process, it turns out, is being outsourced to countries with the dirtiest power grid. So we are not only outsourcing our production, we're outsourcing and expanding our pollution. As a result, in this current climate, 10% of the world's total carbon footprint comes from the apparel industry. Just to put that in perspective, the aviation industry accounts for 2%. Apparel is also currently the second largest polluter of fresh water globally. So in our industry's race for cheaper inputs, we have found our laborers at the very lowest end of the wage spectrum in countries with few protections for workers. While we can be really proud that our industry can play a significant role in creating jobs and has potential to lift people out of poverty, the devastating truth is that low wages, forced labor, unhealthy and dangerous working conditions, and child labor are now rampant throughout the apparel supply chain. So the consumers' closets are bursting open, our factories are polluting, and our workers are far too often abused. Besides perhaps a few companies that are benefiting from this chaos, it's hard to see who is gaining from this value chain. Even consumers seem to be losing out. If Google searches or Marie Kondo's bestseller is any indication, interest in tidying all this up is at an all-time high. Consumers are just reaching their limit. While the pleasure of cheap fashion is neurologically very real, thank you, Mark, for teaching us that, consumers are equally experiencing the mental exhaustion from the accumulation of all of this cheap clothing. They are magically tidying up and wanting to spend more of their dollars on experiences and values over things. Sarah Quinlan of MasterCard's Market Insight Unit told us she's been seeing these subtle shifts, indicating consumers are less worried about spending money and more concerned with using that money to enhance their lives. It is a sign, perhaps, that we are coming full circle. The binge was fun for a while, but it's no longer fulfilling our desires. So that's a snapshot of where we are today. A sector that had a new business model form around a change in economic regulation, which in turn has benefited some while also fueling a race to the bottom, leaving the industry as the second greatest polluter and a supply chain deeply linked with low wages, dangerous working conditions, and child and predatory labor. And now with the consumer, that perhaps is showing early signs of exhaustion with the entire enterprise. We have a broken system and a consumer that is really hungry for change. And this scenario means all of us in this room have an opportunity to create a different future. So to get us where we need to go requires the leadership in this room tonight, and innovation across this fashion ecosystem. It requires multilateral institutions from the UN and the World Economic Forum to make the connection between apparel and the environment and economic development. It requires media to uncover the stories of the impact that apparel production has and also guide readers to possible solutions and help them avoid greenwashing. It requires brands to adopt sustainable practices from design through production within their own businesses. It requires influencers, who are some of today's best storytellers, to showcase the beauty and benefits of living simply. That simplicity in mind, body, and clothing is true empowerment. And it requires educational institutions to teach the next generation to consider systems and to lead efforts in research on what the problems are and opportunities for improvement. So tonight, we are very honored to have those innovators in the true spirit of that word. They are taking leadership positions in their respective fields to bring this enormous $2 trillion industry to its next chapter. So thank you. So turning now to our first category, our first honoree is industry advocate, where our honoree is Sarah Slutsky. So having cut her teeth at Vogue, Sarah Slutsky, a woman of boundless energy, has taken on two groundbreaking roles, one in the world of tech and the other as a celebrity stylist, which has landed her on Hollywood Reporter's most powerful stylist list. Sarah has used this very rarefied position to start changing the conversation among the influential Hollywood elite. Working with Emma Watson, Sarah has launched the 30 Wears campaign, challenging the industry to demonstrate more than single-use fashion. She has also worked with her clients to bring sustainable fashion onto the red carpet. Celebrities, of course, have an enormous influence on society, which makes the conversation that Sarah's bringing to this world powerful and really exciting. So please join me in welcoming Sarah to the stage to accept her honor. I'm back. Hi, guys. So I'm Sarah. Thank you, Maxine, Nita, who's somewhere in the room back there, everyone at Zadie, who really has inspired me countlessly with their stories. The new standard is really, I mean, it's something I turn to every day, so thank you. Also, thank you, Parsons, for this platform for tonight's conversation. So, a little bit about me. I'm a stylist, and every day I'm privileged, I'm humbled to work with some of today's most inspiring and thoughtful women in Hollywood. Also, I'm a VP of Special Projects at a new company called Cinematique. We are a touchable video platform that enables education and enhanced engagement in video through richer and more intimate storytelling. These features, we believe, really can successfully drive a viewer to action. So, I had been asking myself in preparation for this evening, how do these duo career paths lead me to be speaking here tonight? I guess the answer is really through a series of very normal life events. Starting with being a student. In school, I learned about supply chain. I learned about the design process. I learned about the people, start to finish, making clothes. From there, I became a manager, and I watched an eager team of young individuals become professionals with so much to contribute.
From there, working as a collaborator with some of the most incredibly talented women I've had the pleasure to ever meet, and eventually as a decision maker, helping to launch a company. Through all of this, I have been forced to think about the patterns of my everyday life, the decisions I make, and how they impact not just the group directly around me, but a global team of unseen hands that are giving me the tools in both lines of work. Okay. So it wasn't too long before I was aware of how our industry, an industry that I love and I care about deeply, has become flawed. As a child, I thought Michigan Avenue in Chicago, where I grew up, was a museum. I would explore this with my grandmother. She would take me downtown and she would stop and we would marvel at the handicraft and the fabrics and the beautiful, beautiful pieces of clothes that, to me, were truly artifacts. As I became a teenager, fashion was a vehicle for provocative thinking. It was aspirational art with the capacity to merge some of the world's greatest innovators, cultures, and stories. So I still get butterflies at Fashion Week, and while putting finishing touches on my red carpet looks, also speaking in public, I have to say, I am worried about the lasting effects fast fashion, social media, general overexposure has brought to our very creative industry. In the past several years, I cannot ignore the unhealthy aspects of the industry that has not just affected the 1 in 6 people that work in the global garment industry, but us. Us who consume and wear clothes. I worry that we're perpetuating this cycle and sending a message that more is more instead of less is more. We can have whatever we want because it's inexpensive, and in turn, we're supporting supply chain that is very much in need of an overhaul. But you know, I'm actually really excited because we're here together, and that's the first step. Today, I really believe fashion is still a place for risk takers. I believe fashion serves as a medium used uniquely by most people, and it has the power to better the lives of so many individuals, start to finish, supply chain to final wear. I hope that through my work as a stylist, in collaboration with my very amazing clients, the value of each garment, the talent and hours of work put in by designers and their dedicated teams, and the love that goes into each look created can be conveyed. It's with this in mind that I have dedicated and decided it's time to commit to care for my own personal wardrobe. This allows me not only to contribute in a small way to this ominous problem, but has also in turn made me a healthier and happier individual. Also at Cinematique, I hope that brands will be able to communicate their story, what makes them special, sharing their inspiration and why fashion is valuable. I'm hoping to help people can understand why and what they're investing in. So I'm excited tonight that we can have this little chat, and each of us can maybe learn some new habits that can help us to apply to a bigger change. So thank you.
So our second honoree, thank you so much, Sarah, that was beautifully said. Our second honoree tonight is for media and research, and that honor goes to Marc Bain, who's the fashion reporter for Quartz. So as information sharers, media plays a critical role in the fashion ecosystem. And Marc consistently brings unique insights by bridging fashion with the world around him, helping all of us understand the connection between the industry and economics, technology, history, the environment, psychology, and politics. And we at Zadie, as we develop the new standard, which is our internal standard for production, we use Marc's insights, and he's been frequently cited throughout the new standard. He's really just done a magnificent job of just cutting right through the industry, sharing those insights in a really impactful way with really great graphs, I have to say. Thank you for that. And for helping all of us understand the role that fashion plays in the broader world, we are really delighted and honored tonight to honor Marc Bain.
Hi, everybody. Well, I really want to start by saying thank you to Zadie and to Parsons. It really means a lot to be recognized. I've been a reporter at Quartz for just over a year, so not terribly long. It feels like a long time. I've written a lot in that space. But the way I actually got into fashion is a little bit roundabout. So I'll tell you a little bit about my background. I actually started as a reporter at Newsweek many years ago now, covering like health and medicine, that sort of stuff. I grew up always being interested in clothing for whatever reason. I'll cut ahead through kind of a circuitous route. I ended up working for a menswear brand in New York. So I get into this industry, the fashion industry, knowing pretty much nothing about it. And I ended up working in the production department, basically, more or less being the production department. Brands in New York tend to be very small. So it was really eye-opening to see kind of the supply chain, how it works, the cost structure of everything. And for like a small brand in New York that was making high-end clothing, everything's manufactured in New York. And then I would go into Uniqlo and see like, you know, an $89 cashmere sweater. And it was just mind-blowing to me. I just always wondered how it was possible. And so that kind of opened my eyes. That started a process of just kind of wanting to learn more. So skip ahead a little bit more. I worked in the fashion industry doing a few other things, but I continued reporting as a freelancer. Anyway, I ended up interviewing at Quartz. And Quartz, for those of you who don't know it, it's like a global business and news site. It's a pretty serious journalism. And I loved it, having come from a news background. And it was interesting to me that they wanted a fashion reporter, not like a fashion critic. It wasn't like getting a job at Vogue necessarily. Their readership is very different. Their goals are very different. And so I'm still very grateful that I got the job. It's a terrific place to work at. And the thing that most intrigued me about it, they didn't really give me a directive. It was more kind of looking around at my coworkers, who are all insanely smart, knowledgeable people, and wondering, you know, how I could cover fashion in a way that was smart and hopefully, you know, meaningful, beyond just covering, you know, what products I may have liked or something like that. And that kind of set me off on a path of trying to look at fashion from the perspective of, all right, how does this actually matter in people's lives? And there are a lot of things that came up. One, as Maxine mentioned, was like psychology. There are a lot of studies done on shopping behavior, that sort of thing. And that was always really interesting to me. So I would write about that. One thing that definitely always kind of came up and continues to come up, now having been there for more than a year, was sustainability and the industry's impact on a whole bunch of different things, on the environment, on workers, on, you know, people's closets. And so I knew a little bit about that, but as a reporter, you know, your job is to kind of dig. So I started digging a little more and started thinking about, well, you know, when I worked for that menswear brand, we'd buy fabric, but, you know, you buy it as fabric, you don't buy raw cotton. So I started looking at, you know, where raw cotton comes from, that sort of thing. And the more you do that, you keep kind of pulling the string and going back, you see a lot of very kind of problematic facts start to emerge. For instance, I have a whole bunch of facts listed here, so please bear with me. I should also point out that I am much more a writer than a speaker. I don't normally do this sort of stuff. But to make a pair of jeans, for instance, requires about 1,800 gallons of water. A t-shirt is about 700 gallons. That is from, sorry, I'm looking at my source, the Chemical and Engineering News. I'm like obsessed with sourcing all my data, by the way. So you look at things like that, and it's, you know, it's really kind of troublesome. You start to wonder how much of that is being used for fabric when there's, you know, serious problems with water scarcity in the world. And then you start to look into, all right, well, they grow the cotton, and then what happens to it? Then it's, you know, it's turned into a fabric, and it's dyed and finished. And once you learn about dyeing and finishing, that's probably even more horrible. Actually, well, we can, there's a step in between that's also pretty horrible. There is a lot of forced and child labor involved in cotton farming in countries like Turkmenistan and Uzbekistan. And the difficulty with that is, you know, having come from this menswear brand, you buy the cotton finished, you don't necessarily know where they got all the products from. And this leads me to something I'll talk about later, which is that when you get to these high level sort of things, like really big companies, it's pretty impossible to know who's making the clothing, the provenance of the materials that were used to make it, and all this sort of stuff. And that lack of transparency allows for a lot of these things to happen. But so you get into textile dyeing and finishing, you learn that there are more than 8,000 chemicals used to dye and finish textiles. One Chinese government estimate put the amount of shallow and deep groundwater that's severely polluted in the North China Plains, which is home to a significant chunk of the country's farmlands, at more than 70%. So more than 70% of that land is polluted because of textile dyeing and finishing. So, you know, this is all disastrous, and then you think about, all right, well, so they have the fabric, then what happens? I had the benefit of working at a company that made everything in New York. A lot of places don't do that. As Maxine was saying, due to globalization, you know, trade barriers went down, it got cheaper to do things overseas, and so everyone went to where it was cheap. China is the big one, and it still is, has been for decades. But as China develops, other countries, especially South Asian countries like Bangladesh and Vietnam, are becoming go-to sources for production. And a big part of the reason is because as wages rose in China, they didn't really so much in places like Bangladesh. So for instance, the Just Jobs Network did a report. In 2001, the monthly wage for a garment worker in China, adjusted for purchasing power, was about $145. By 2011, that had doubled. Bangladesh, by contrast, in that same time period, it actually decreased around $2. So in that decade, it decreased to about $91.45 for a garment worker's monthly wages. So you kind of understand, well, you know, you start to see how these massive brands make things very cheaply. And understandably, you know, labor is a big part of it. Textiles are a big part of it. So they're paying as little as possible for all these things. And then you get to a situation like Rana Plaza. And Rana Plaza didn't come out of nowhere. It was not exactly an accident in that it was, I think, the result of, you know, a lot of neglect and a lot of active neglect, we can put it that way. Today it is being remediated, but it's still very slow going. The two groups that are working on it are the Accord and the Alliance. As a reporter, I've done a lot of reporting on this, and I've spoken to them a lot. And just talking to them and learning about the Bangladesh garment industry also reveals how difficult it is to know exactly what's going on. So for instance, in October, I spoke to the Accord. October was roughly 2.5 years after Rana Plaza. And after Rana Plaza, the Accord and the Alliance agreed to, if you don't know what they are, by the way, they are like coalitions between like fashion companies and trade unions. And they both came up with these five-year plans to remediate a big part of the garment industry there. So October was about halfway through that five-year plan. And the Accord told me very honestly that they were way behind. Things were not particularly going well. It's a very difficult task, as you can imagine. Last week, the Alliance had their own update. So that was about, you know, 3 years. And they said everything is great. Oddly, so about half of the repairs had been done that they had set out to do from their first inspections, pretty much right on schedule. Fires had dropped more than 90%. So those are very positive statistics, which is great, but it's, you know, as a reporter, it's kind of difficult to know which version is closer to the truth without actually being on the ground yourself. And even then, from everything I've heard, talking to a lot of people, it is very, very difficult to get an accurate picture of the industry. And how difficult it is, I will get to now. It's not even clear how many factories there are in Bangladesh's garment industry. Officially, there are about 3,200, but there are a lot of unofficial factories as well. NYU's Stern Center for Human Rights did this very long study on the ground in Bangladesh, and they concluded that there are more than 7,000 factories, so more than double the number that are, you know, are listed as official garment exporters. The unofficial ones, by the way, are often in the worst shape. Because they're off the grid, they're not following any regulations, that sort of thing. So it gives you a sense of just how problematic that industry is. The Accord and the Alliance, by the way, are overseeing repairs on about 2,000 factories. So even if they covered everything they've set out to cover, they're still missing a big chunk of it. So, however, that 7,000 factories figure was disputed by Bangladesh's Garment Manufacturers and Exporters Association. They said it was more like 3,500. So they're saying that was half the number. Another independent report came out, this one by two other academics, one at Penn State, that also criticized the 7,000 figure, saying it was inflated by at least 2,000 factories. So which number is right, I have no idea. It's really difficult to say, and all you can really do is rely on people doing the hard work on the ground, and me as a reporter relying on their hard work very much. And I think that tells you also kind of what kind of situation you're looking at when you talk about, you know, Bangladesh's garment industry. They started with a massive task. From everyone I've spoke to, almost every factory they set out to inspect had, you know, maybe dozens of issues, not more. So things such as no effective fire doors or alarm systems, they lacked properly constructed safety exits. Many had gates to lock their employees in, and improper electrical wiring, no plan for weight management. So, you know, you'd get these multi-floor factories stacked with these heavy machines and lots of employees, and you get a situation like Rana Plaza if the building is not structurally sound. Things like fire doors, fires are a huge issue because the electrical wiring is so bad. You don't have proper fire doors. The hallways, the exit hallways fill with smoke and they're impassable, and you know, it becomes a death trap, very literally. You saw some of that at like the Tazreen factory fire that happened before Rana Plaza. I don't want to give the impression that this is all, pure exploitation. These jobs do help Bangladeshis a lot. Garment jobs, they're easy to get into. For some of the poorest people in the world, they actually offer a lifeline. In Bangladesh in particular, you know, they've helped a huge portion of the population actually come out of poverty. But they do so through these very low-paid, very grueling jobs. So another thing I've learned as a reporter is you are constantly confronted by contradictions like this one. So, you know, as a consumer, it's hard to know. Do you buy from Bangladesh or not? It's like there's no way to know what the factory was like, anything like that. So you just hope the conditions were as good as they could have been and that, you know, people were treated fairly, that sort of thing. The industry I'm talking about, by the way, is mostly the big players in the less expensive fashion, companies like H&M and Gap and Zara and Uniqlo. Luxury fashion is not exempt. Just because something was manufactured in Europe doesn't mean it was perfectly ethical or that the cotton in a $150 t-shirt was more sustainably grown than the cotton in a $10 t-shirt. But these companies are the ones that are, you know, primarily doing the sourcing from these areas. And they're volume businesses. And that's a big part of the problem, is just that business model, the volume business model of you know, they're selling very inexpensive clothing. And so, for instance, H&M last year had total sales of about $25 billion. Zara had sales of about $23 billion. This is according to their most recent annual reports. And so when you think of the number of t-shirts and dresses and pairs of jeans and everything else they had to sell to reach those numbers, and exactly how they do it, how they keep the prices so low, it all becomes very sort of mind-blowing. And again, I came into this, you know, a little more than a year ago, kind of knowing about fashion. I knew that I liked clothes and some designer brands, but I didn't know a lot of this stuff. So it was really interesting to kind of pick it up along the way. Amancio Ortega, by the way, the founder of Inditex, which is Zara's parent company, briefly overtook Bill Gates as the richest man on earth last year. The Inditex stock jumped up, and according to Bloomberg, he actually bumped ahead of Bill Gates for a little bit. But that just gives you some indication of how profitable an industry it is, and how much stuff they're selling. So, as Maxine was saying, we buy more than ever, and we pay less than we ever did. There is something very psychologically appealing about that. We get a little buzz from shopping, and we don't really get the pain of having to pay up a lot for it. Certain shops, they get clothing in very frequently. It makes it possible for you to go back all the time and just keep getting that little buzz. And it seems innocuous enough until, you know, you step back and you think about how much clothing winds up in landfills. I believe there was, no, it's not running now. I know, so about 10.5 million, I believe it's tons of clothing end up in American landfills each year. Which is pretty horrifying when you think about it. And the problem with a lot of that too, even with organic or like, you know, natural fibers, cotton doesn't just break down. Like, just because you throw it in a landfill, it actually doesn't break down any better than polyester unless you compost it and turn it over and give it nutrients. And that doesn't happen. If you look at pictures of landfills, the cotton t-shirt will just sit there in the dark without oxygen. Indefinitely, kind of. I learned this actually speaking to a very smart woman named Linda Greer at the NRDC, who I think some of you may have worked with before. And that was kind of eye-opening, too, to think about. It's like, all right, so it goes through this whole process, and you think, like, if I buy the cotton version, maybe that's better, except it isn't necessarily. The point of all this is not to make everybody horribly depressed. It's basically to indicate that, you know, everything you buy is an investment, and you should treat it as an investment. You are kind of a part of its journey as much as it's a part of yours. That cotton t-shirt that started as a plant, you know, probably in China or maybe even in Texas, you know, it's gone through a lot of hands before ending up as a t-shirt in your closet. I think it's valuable to step back and to think about all the people who worked on it. And then also to think about what's gonna happen to it after you're done with it. And to think about that stuff not only when it's in your closet, but also before you put it there. So, you know, before you stop and buy something, you should think about whether or not you really want it, where it came from and where you see it going.
We did say Marc is filled with knowledge. and I think that kind of background is actually a perfect segue to our final category this evening, which is the honor for industry titan. Because oftentimes we are asked when we speak about sustainability, when we speak about doing things right, a frequent answer back to us is, well, how are you doing it that at scale? Like, you know, you can start out that way, but there's no company that's really doing the right thing at large scale. And Patagonia is the company that I always get to respond with. So we're really thrilled to honor Rick Ridgeway. It's hard really to speak with great enough accolades for the role that Rick and through him Patagonia has played in leading this industry. So for most of the company's existence, Patagonia has been at the leading edge of efforts to steer the clothing industry in a more sustainable direction. And kind of bridging Mr. Ridgeway's background with what Marc was talking about, you know, you spoke about this kind of consumption and that we have to think about how long we're going to have something. And it was really through reading about Patagonia and your approach, Rick, that we got to learn about thinking about our clothing as something we own rather than something we consume. For over 30 years, Patagonia has donated 1% of their annual sales to environmental charities and grassroots organizations. The company views these contributions not just as arbitrary form of corporate philanthropy, but as one of their standard costs of doing business and something that is much more a core element of Patagonia than just selling shirts and jackets. Patagonia has not been content merely ensuring that their own operations are run sustainably. In 2010, Rick himself, helped found the Sustainable Apparel Coalition, an alliance of clothing and footwear companies working to create an industry tool that clothing industry executives can use to make more sustainable decisions when sourcing materials and developing products. They have also explored new business models that better embody their principles of sustainability and responsible growth. In 2012, Patagonia was one of the first California companies to become a registered B Corporation. This is the status that frees American companies from their legal requirements to deliver maximum returns for shareholders, releasing the company to pursue a mission for their betterment of the environment or wider society. I hope that's the last legal thing I have to talk about. As Patagonia's Vice President of Environmental Affairs, Rick Ridgeway has been the leader of this ethos within the company. He implements the second of the company's 2-3-part mission statement to make the best product, cause no unnecessary harm, and use business to inspire and implement solutions to the environmental crisis. In addition to leading the apparel industry to a more sustainable future, Rick also is a mountaineer and adventurer, making the first American ascent of K2. Yeah, that's right. He has produced and directed several documentary films, written dozens of magazine articles, and 6 books. We are so thrilled to honor Patagonia and Rick Ridgeway for their role as Titan.
Thanks, Maxine. I'm a little short to be a Titan. A few years ago, we ran in the New York Times full page that now famous ad with an illustration of our best-selling jacket on Black Friday. And when the salespeople at the newspaper received our order, they got really excited, thinking they had a new client. And then they got a little perplexed when we asked them to run the ad at the very end of the front page section, behind all the other full page ads from companies trying to persuade us to buy their stuff. And then they were truly shocked when they got the art comp, and above the illustration of the jacket was the bold headline, "Don't buy this jacket." And we did that to shock everyone into reading the copy of the ad, because there we explain that despite our mission, as Maxine said, to make the best product with no unnecessary harm, despite our very best efforts, that jacket still required 135 liters of water. It still produced 20 pounds of greenhouse gas emissions. It still left behind 2/3 of its weight in waste. So that our effort to cause no unnecessary harm was still causing a lot of harm. We wanted the ad to start a conversation about consumption, because we had been having that same conversation internally for some time. I remember a meeting a few years ago with our CEO and our CFO, the vice presidents of all of our business units, and Yvonne Chouinard, the founder of the company, who with his wife and 2 children still own Patagonia as a privately held company. And the vice president of marketing, who's not with us anymore, got up and showed the comps for the upcoming holiday Christmas catalog. And of course, like all of our catalogs, it was really beautiful. And at the end, he looked at Yvonne and said, "What do you think?" And Yvonne says, "I think you're trying to sell a lot of shit to a lot of people that don't need it." So at our company, the key performance indicators the businesses use to measure the health of their businesses, for us, the KPIs that at the highest level measure the health of our business are the ones that measure the health of our planet. And those numbers are tanking. Every year, the global temperatures rise. Every year, the P parts per million of atmospheric CO2 goes up. Every year, the rate of deforestation increases, the rate of desertification, the rate of freshwater eutrophication, of ocean acidification, the rate of the loss of biodiversity, the continued crisis of the extinction of species on our planet. These are our KPIs because we remember the guidance of our mentor, David Brower, who for us is the founder of the modern American environmental movement. And David reminded us, all of us especially who are in business, that there is no business on a dead planet. So how do you square on a planet with a globalized economy a business model that asks their customers not to buy their stuff? Well, it starts with that business mission that Maxine mentioned: build the best product, cause no unnecessary harm, use our business to inspire and implement solutions to the environmental crisis. So those first two parts, build the best product, cause no unnecessary harm. The first one is best product. That's key. Everything flows from that. And for us, best product is an optimized combination of best design, of best environmentally preferred materials, of best construction. Because when you optimize those things, the result is best durability. And durability turns out to be the biggest component in the environmental footprint of a product. So that when that jacket in our ad services its owner for 5 years, and then 10 years, and then 15 years, and maybe 20 years, that with each of those integrals, the footprint of that jacket decreases exponentially. Best product turns out to be a key environmental component. Now, when you add to that the initiative that we call Warnware, a partnership with our customers to provide them the service of best repair, make it as easy as we can for them to fix it if it's broken, to make it easy for them to clean out their closets and garages if they're not using it and put it in the hands of somebody that will, so they use it more than the 7 times that we heard from Maxine, so that at the true end of its life, they bring it back to us and we can use the best available technology to recycle it. And combine that with our ask in the first place not to buy it if they don't really need it, then as we grow, we feel that we're actually adding more solutions than we are as a business creating problems. Now, we're, of course, not the only ones out there looking out onto the horizon line, optimizing our business model and future-proofing it against these long-term trends. Other companies, like our colleagues at Zadie's, are doing this as well. But also, we're encouraged by the number of other large companies who are starting to catch on. They're starting to recognize the business value that comes from these investments in sustainability. They're understanding the money that they can actually save from reducing environmental impacts in their supply chain, reducing energy inputs, reducing costs, toxics, all these things, reducing waste can save money. They're realizing at the same time that managing those things reduce risk. And as they do that, some of them are also getting rewarded from their customers, from their stakeholders. The leading companies are also beginning to recognize that sustainability commitments are influencing the value of their stock, that large publicly held companies are recognizing that fund managers are using sustainability screens to place their bets as they build their portfolios. The leading companies are beginning to realize that as they manage the carbon intensity in their operations and in their supply chain, that they're creating a competitive advantage when, and I say when, not if, more countries begin to impose carbon taxes. So they're beginning to realize that without these sustainability commitments, that without these commitments to reduce their environmental impacts, without the commitments to improve the lives of the workers in their companies, and even more importantly, in their supply chains, that without these commitments made with transparency and without hypocrisy, that the best and the brightest coming out of our country's colleges and universities, out of our business schools, out of Parsons and the New School, that they're not going to work for them. That is really getting on their radar, and it's getting on their radar in a big way. And I can tell you that directly because I have direct conversations with the CEOs of just about all these big companies. So, to those of you in the audience who are students and looking around the room, that's probably a lot of you. It's over to you guys. And I say thank God. And I also say thank you to Zadie's for this recognition.
Don't sit down, Rick, because you're going to stand right back up if that's okay. All of the honorees can just join. We're going to have a quick panel discussion. And though I think the audience looks incredibly young, they are all kind of leaders in their respective field. So I think we can have a really interesting conversation about kind of what we know now and kind of where we're going in the future. So. Rick, I think it goes back often. Can you hear me? This works. Okay, thank you. To the mission of the company. So I'd love to hear kind of more what inspires Patagonia to maintain its mission of sustainability. Where is that coming from?
Well, first, I said to you a minute ago that I have the privilege of talking to the leaders of a lot of companies, and I am often invited inside, so I get to see how they do it firsthand. And I've never found one that uses their mission statement to guide their decisions on a daily and long-term basis as much as Patagonia. So that mission, even though we have a very horizontal culture, imposes a very verticality to the organization that's kind of like a, like being a Buddhist where you police yourself or you come back as a bug or something. Well, everyone at Patagonia uses the mission to guide their decisions. So in a very horizontal culture, we have this really interesting vertical component. But your question was why? You know, why have a company whose last part of a very complex mission is to inspire and implement solutions to the environmental crisis? And the answer is rooted in the fact that the company comes out of we who practice these outdoor sports. We're at our founding level and even across the company today with the young people in our business, many of us, climbers and surfers and backcountry skiers who have grown up in the wilds of the world, and certainly speaking for Yvonne and myself, in our lifetimes, we've witnessed firsthand those places that we have grown to love so much actually degrading, that through human development, they've fragmented into smaller and smaller parts. And now through human-caused climate change, they're right in front of our eyes under enormous stress. People sometimes ask me what my favorite climb is, and it's actually, well, it was a route called the Ice Window on Mount Kenya, right on the equator in East Africa. And that climb's not there anymore. It's gone forever because of climate change. So we've seen these things firsthand. We've seen the places we love degrade in our lifetimes. And what are you going to do when you have a business, when you see these things that you care and you love about? Well, for us, the answer is to use our business as a tool for environmental protection. That's why we are in business. The owner, Yvonne, his family, they drive around and beat up old cars. They have modest houses. They fly coach. I fly so much, I get upgraded. Last time I went on a trip with Yvonne, he's in the back of the plane with, right, sandwiched between two very large people. And I even said, God, you're still in the back of the plane. He goes, I'm not going to give the money to those airlines. We got to give it to the environmental groups.
So the next question is for Sarah. The idea of mindfulness in fashion is new, particularly among celebrities where often excess is celebrated. So how did you find yourself thinking about these things, and how are you translating that in your work?
Yes, so, you know, it's a really big question. There's a lot of routes to take when you are creating a look and telling a story of fashion, and I think, you know, the training that we receive is, you know, be at the forefront and, you know, think outside the box and, you know, what can you discover that hasn't already been done? And in that notion, the instinct is that you have to fill yourself with more and you can't reinvent. And, you know, I think for me, from the beginning, I was definitely guilty of the mid-90s, you know, Forever 21 came to my town and, like, this is so exciting. And, you know, it was a moment where we had to sit down and sit back and think that, you know, there's no way that changing a look every single time is actually a good message to be sending. It's not scalable, it's not attainable, and it certainly isn't making us feel healthy. So, you know, I think in conversation with some of my clients, where we realized, you know, how much back and forth is happening and how much of our own waste is being generated through receiving one bag and then sending it back and then, you know, requesting 25 different things that come from the same place and arrive in their own boxes, that, you know, everything we're doing to send this message that fashion is a vehicle for creativity and powerful tool at that to be your best self, actually we weren't being really great ourselves in creating that. So the question about how do we put it into practice, I mean, I think it's a slow one. It's something that I'm working on every day, and I'm really grateful for the brand partners who understand and receive the message. But I think it's a general effort just to slow down and think, do we have this? Can we repurpose it? Can we use it? How can we love it more and love it again? And
So, Marc, let's get out my notes here. Sorry, that's not the right question. That's a picture of Dubai. Okay, so you have come up with so much of the, you know, pulled together so much interesting data and research. Are you finding interest from your readership on these impacts, and what kind of questions are they asking?
Yeah, I find readers tend to respond really well when it's something they didn't already know, and a lot of people don't know a lot of the stuff that we're talking about. I suspect a lot of the people in this room are very well educated on fashion and its impact on the environment, that sort of thing. But you know, the average consumer, I think, is still in a learning process. I think it actually reminds me a lot of the way you know, people have been thinking about food over the last, you know, however many years, decades, where now I think the average person is a lot more educated on that, but it is a learning process. So yeah, I don't get a lot of actual questions. I do get a lot of feedback, though. Facebook comments are mostly mean, as you can probably guess. But there are some, you know, there is some genuine feedback. And the stuff that I find that kind of resonates with people is anything that they can actually put into practice. I think that's a big thing. The one article I've written that I've gotten the most positive feedback on was arguing that your next item of clothing, you should spend so much that it hurts, which is kind of a funny way of putting it. But it goes back to the point that I was making, that actually, psychologically, there's like a little bit of competition going on in a purchase. There's like this hedonic competition of, you know, the pleasure of the purchase versus the actual pain of the buying. And my point was just that as clothing has gotten cheaper, we don't really have that pain so much. And I think it is actually worthwhile to spend more money per item of clothing. And there are a lot of different reasons for that. My limit, by the way, was about $150. So to try to spend at least $150 per purchase. I should add the caveat that for a lot of people, that's too much, you know, for a lot of like working families and, you know, that sort of thing. But the point was that it's an individual level that everyone has to figure out. But for me, that amount makes me kind of sweat. It makes me pause and think, do I really want this? And I've found that just doing that over the last year or so, I didn't set out to do it consciously. It wasn't like, you know, like a weird gimmick. I'm not writing a book about my experience or anything. But it, you know, it made me think about what I was buying, whether I really wanted it, and whether I was willing to invest that amount of money in it. And I've found that it's kind of changed the way I appreciate clothing and the way I shop. I buy less, but I buy better. And I think that's something a lot of readers, you know, they want to do. And it sounds silly, like setting a price floor. It seems like a fairly simple thing, but I think a lot of people actually responded to it because it is simple. So yeah, I don't get a ton of actual questions, but you know, on occasion I do get like feedback on what's really resonated with people.
Thanks. So this evening is about the future of fashion. And so I wanted to kind of ask all of you, where do you see the apparel industry going? And from each of your vantage points, what role do you see you and your colleagues having in shaping that future? Let's start with Sarah.
Questions. Yeah, I think in the last several months to year of trying to figure out where the clothes I'm working with come from, my general goal was just to really spark a conversation, to see what is known on the PR level, on the production level, on the, you know, VIP events coordinators level. And The reactions are very mixed. You know, sometimes you have the, oh, you know, we can't speak to that, we can't answer it. Other times you get a thank you, let me look into it. And as I've asked the question more, I've become more comfortable with it, first of all, because it's not a bad question to be asking. Originally, I was very nervous. But I think the general sentiment is we need more people asking these questions. Consumers, you know, everyone shopping should be asking these questions, looking at the labels, because the future of fashion depends on us as, you know, people wearing clothes saying we need to care where it comes from, and we need to decide that when we do buy something, it's a commitment to keep. You know, personally, I'm on a 30 wears mission, which Maxine touched on briefly, and to some people it seems really, really trivial, but to me it was actually, this is something I need to dedicate myself to and figure out, you know, the last thing that I wore, how am I going to keep wearing it over and over and over again until it either falls apart or, you know, I need to hand it on to my next friend. But I think the more we ask these questions, the more brands can look to one another for support and advice and help with creating change. I think this is a very collective shift that needs to happen. It can't be, you know, isolated to one group versus another. You know, our Earth, I very much believe, depends on it. We as humans depend on it. We can't continue to consume and consume and consume and feel good about ourselves. So, yeah, I hope the future of fashion is collaboration to create a unified and much more, as Rick has pointed out, you know, sustainable but healthy environment for us.
I'm fascinated following the development of the Sustainable Apparel Coalition that we co-founded in 2010. Just the 6-year interim, or less actually, 5.5, it's become the biggest apparel trade organization in the world with 185 members representing about 40% of the entire global apparel and footwear and textile industries. And its mission is to create measurement tools for decision makers to make better decisions, and then ultimately to put those tools into the hands of consumers so they can make more informed choices as well. I mean, we're on track on all those things, but as the measurement has improved, as the baselines are now coming out, as the tools are being scaled, that's happening right now. There's 3,000 or 4,000 factories that have been measured with the tools, and a year from now it'll probably be 10,000 to 12,000 or 15,000. With that measurement, it's being coupled with increased transparency, like it or not, through social media, of course, but through some government drivers as well. The measurements are, I think, will be more publicly transparent, and that's going to unleash a whole another set of drivers. So things are going in a improving direction. Be really, you know, I'm the it's not yet proven that the Apparel Coalition is a success. As the guy who founded the whole thing, it was actually my idea. I'm the first to say the experiment is underway. We're creating the baselines, we're measuring. The only way we'll ever claim success in that effort is if year to year those measurements show improvements in the reduction on the planet from the environmental impacts of the industry and from the improvement of the lives of the people that are in the industry. So it's an experiment that's still underway, and whether it succeeds or not, is we'll see. But again, a lot of things are going in the right direction. I think, and then the end game for all this, in my view anyway, is to influence government, to impose measurement by policy requirement, and then to use that imposition for the transparent public release of that measurement to create uniform and standardized measurement and drivers across the globe. And it's starting to happen. The EU has passed a policy that will require a consumer-facing label measuring the environmental impact of all products sold in the EU by 2020. And we're working very closely with them, trying to encourage them to just adopt the apparel coalition's tools called the Higg Index. So it's going in the right direction. I'm not going to claim victory until it's measurable. There's one other thing I'll add, which is not necessarily part of the answer, but I wanted to get a chance to throw this in because it's been mentioned several times by me and all of us in one way or another. And that's the role that durability, as I said in my talk, has to play in this. And I wanted to add that my own view that I think it has a role in fashion as well. I don't personally think there is a business model future for fast fashion in fashion because of those long-term trends that I spoke about. It's out of sync, doesn't work, doesn't square. It's unsustainable. But investing in quality, as Marc has said, is to me where you guys should be thinking about heading. And I have a little story about when I married my wife 34 years ago. She lived here in New York and worked for Calvin Klein. And she was one of the early people in the company. I think she was within the first 10 employees. And in fact, she might have been in the first five or six. And her job was to get dressed up and look hot and go out with Calvin and go make the sales calls. But she is a really sharp businesswoman. So then they'd get back and she would unload with Calvin what she thought things were going. So anyway, we met each other. And for I don't know why, because she's still not sure exactly how that happened. I mean, not how we met, but why it went anywhere. I didn't have a lot of social skills. I may not still have that many. For example, on our first date, I invited Yvonne to come along. And she told me later her first thought as we picked her up in Yvonne's car was that her dress had to be worth at least four times as much as the automobile. So when we married, she had a lot of Calvin's best stuff. And they were products that had been made, you know, impeccably with the best craftsmanship, with the very best and finest materials. But I might also add with really, you know, timeless classic design. So now, 34 years into the marriage, and some of those products were much older than that when we were married. Some of them are over 40 years old now, and she still wears them. And our two daughters still wear them, and they look great in them. Now, I told you that the footprint of a product goes down over time. So imagine how small the footprint of those items are. So it can be done.
So the question was about how do I see the future of the apparel industry? And this is all just purely a guess. I'm very bad at predicting things. So I do think very large companies have realized that they have to pay attention to their footprint, their sustainability. I think a new generation of consumers is growing up who cares about that stuff. And if they care about that stuff and they they vote with their dollars, then these companies have to pay attention. And I think you see it in a lot of companies, developing these corporate sustainability reports, like Nike and Adidas and H&M. They all put this stuff out. At the same time, I feel like the production cycle is not really slowing down any. I think companies are producing more. And H&M is a company I've reported on a lot because I find them. They do a lot of things that show that they really are committed to improving their footprint. But then they also do stuff like they plan to double their store footprint in the next 8 years or so. They'll have about 8,000 stores globally at that point. This is a comment I believe the CEO recently made that was reported by Bloomberg. And so, you know, it becomes hard to square like how all these large companies, not just them, anyone else, you know, how do they seriously look at their environmental impact and really try to, you know, reduce it while also producing more? I think another big part of this is as China develops as a country, a lot of brands are looking to it as, you know, a big growth area. And they have been for a while now, but it's, you know, as the middle class grows there, it's really like taking off. And, you know, it's millions, hundreds of millions of consumers and, you know, more people that want stuff. And for large publicly traded companies where they are, you know, beholden to shareholders, that sort of thing, it's a great growth opportunity. But it's also very problematic in terms of like how are you actually going to reduce your footprint when you're trying to double it otherwise? You want to double your sales and, you know, cut your carbon in half. It's very difficult. So I don't really know is what I'm trying to say where things are going, because there seem to be a lot of competing interests involved. I do see some very hopeful signs. I think there is some sort of feel like I see at least a lot of new brands starting that are rethinking the way things are done, including Zadie, including Benno, which part of the team is here today. They actually started their own factory in India. Another brand is Veja, the sneaker brand. The founders were two crazy guys who decided they were studying sustainability and felt corporations weren't really actually doing that much. So they started sourcing directly from the Amazon rainforest and just doing things themselves. And I hope at least that a lot more people start trying to do that sort of thing, really having the guts to start businesses that just ignore everything that everyone before them has done and say, we're gonna try to do it a different way, a way that we think is better and that, you know, works for us. So as to where the apparel industry is going, I do feel like it's gonna get actually more fragmented. And then none of this is talking about the luxury industry, which is another huge part of the apparel industry. You know, these big conglomerates like Kering and LVMH and those brands, there's evidence to indicate they are also kind of churning out more stuff. Some of them are, you know, trying to resist that, but I'm sure you can, you know, you'll read about it on Quartz.
Thank you. First I wanted to thank so much the honorees for being here with us tonight. So I also wanted to thank the audience, and I don't actually like the word audience in this case, because it really is, you guys have each individually been invited for a reason, and we are so honored that you took a very important evening out to listen, to converse, to think about these things. There are incredible people that I get to look at right now, and I hope everyone just gets some time to talk to one another. It's a really interesting group of people that have really have not ever been in one room together, so that is just a really exciting moment for us. So kind of on that front, you were given Post-it notes, which I am from Minnesota, so I think legally obligated to say that that's a Minnesota company. And you can write on those Post-it notes either something that you've learned or something that from tonight you're challenging yourself to do, because all of you come from, you know, very senior leadership positions within this ecosystem. So that board is right there. Hannah will raise her hand. Yay, she's right there. This week is Fashion Revolution Week. This is what is bringing us together. And the way to participate in that is by asking a brand who made my clothes. And we've actually set up right where you see the Z's. Hannah's now standing there. Very cute picture frame where you can already do that there tonight. So hope you have a chance to do that. Check out the amazing drawing that is happening right now of the whole happenings that happened tonight. Thank you very much. and please enjoy some wine and have a great time. And thank you so much.